All right, so today we'll go into chapter 11. And the topic is ANOVA, okay? ANOVA is analysis, stands for analysis of variance. ANOVA, and like, just like the topics for categorical variables or for non-parametric tests, you can take entire courses devoted to ANOVA, and go into it real in depth. Today we are going to learn just the most basic form of ANOVA, which is called one-way ANOVA. This is the most basic form of ANOVA that we will learn for this class, but it's just the skimming the surface of what ANOVA is and what it can do. And so, as you guys, I don't know if you take more statistics classes, maybe you can take a class entirely devoted to ANOVA, depending on what you're interested in. So the idea behind, I shouldn't say the idea behind, but we use ANOVA when we are trying to compare the means from several different groups, okay? So in contrast with a t-test, we can compare the means from two groups. If we have more than two groups, then t-tests are not the the best way to go, okay? And ANOVA is a better way, okay? So just to reiterate, so we use t-tests what this implies or what this means is that we have two variables, one categorical variable, with more than two groups or more than two categories. And we have one numeric variable. Comparing the means of the numeric variable. So I said we use t-tests when we compare the means for two groups, and when we have more than two groups, we should use ANOVA. So let me just kind of illustrate why t-tests don't work as well when we have more than two groups. So let's say we have five different groups, okay? Group one, group two, group three, group 4, and group 5. each of these have, you know, a sample size, a sample mean, and a standard deviation. Okay. So if we wanted to do t-tests, how many? We would have to do a whole bunch of these, okay? We would have to do group 1 versus group 2. Okay. T-test, we would do group 1 versus group 2. And then we would do group 1 versus group 3. Group 1 versus group 4. Group 1 versus 5. And then there would be 2 versus 3, 2 versus 4, 2 versus 5, 3 versus 4, 3 versus 5. So we would have 10 different comparisons to make. So we have to. It's a little bit tedious, a little time-consuming, but it's not too bad, okay? The problem isn't that 10 tests is so much work, okay? Because if you're equipped with a computer, it's just a few quick commands, and it's not too terrible, okay? The problem is we really we run the risk of committing a type 1 error. There's a high probability of committing a type 1 error, okay? Because every time I do a test, the probability of committing a type 1 error is alpha, okay? So maybe if I'm doing these at a 5% type 1 error, I mean 5% significance level, okay? I've got a 5% chance of committing a type 1 error here, okay? And a 5% chance here, and a 5% chance here, okay? So I'm committing 10. Doing 10 tests, essentially, each of them have a 5% chance of type 1 error, right? And which means I have a 95% chance of getting away with it, I mean, of not committing a type 1 error. But what's the probability that I conduct 10 tests and emerge, quote, unscathed, meaning I didn't commit a type 1 error for any of those 10 tests? Essentially, so probability of not committing a type 1 error in 10 tests is approximately, okay, point, you know, let's say if we're doing using alpha equal to 5%, this is approximately 0.95 to the 10. Okay? It's not technically this because this assumes each test is independent of the others, and because we're using the same data or we're sharing the same data, each test is not truly independent of the others. Okay, so it's not exactly this, but let me just figure this out. When you're doing 10 tests, 0.95 to the 10, that's like 0.6, okay? So I only have a 60% chance of not committing a type 1 error. So I've got about a 40% chance that I've made a type 1 error here, okay? After doing 10 tests here. And so that's pretty pretty high, okay? It means maybe one of my tests says there's a difference between the two means, okay? Now, is that truly indication that there's a difference between the two means, or could it just be, you know, I've got a 40% chance that maybe I've made a type one error type of thing? So, so the problem is that when we're doing a whole bunch of t-tests, the probability of type 1 error really gets high, okay, if we do multiple t-tests. And you can only imagine the problem getting worse if we had more than 5 categories, okay, because then we'd have to do another, you know, 15 tests or 21 tests or whatever. This phenomenon is called the problem of multiple comparisons. Right? And there's no real good answer to this problem of multiple comparisons. People have tried to work out different solutions. They say, okay, well, instead of using alpha equal to 5%, for all of these t-tests, use alpha equal to 1% or something, and that will help you reduce the risk of a type 1 error. Okay, but when you reduce alpha, what happens? Your beta goes up. Okay, so there's all sorts of issues there. Problem with a long-standing history that hasn't really been solved, okay? ANOVA comes to kind of a solution, but it's not really a solution, and there's some shortcomings with ANOVA. And I wouldn't say shortcomings, but just there's certain things that ANOVA can't do that a t-test can do. Okay. So, ANOVA helps, but it's not the end all. Okay, so with ANOVA, we can try to compare all of these means all at once. Okay, so with ANOVA, our null hypothesis is that all groups have the same mean. All groups or all respective populations have the same mean. And we say mu1 is equal to mu2 equal to mu3 equal to whatever mu of the kth group. So all of the means are the same. That's our null hypothesis. And the alternative is at least one one of the groups is a different. Okay. So this is what ANOVA tries to do. ANOVA tries to separate out the total variation into two parts, okay? And what I mean by this is that, let me just write this out, okay? So ANOVA tries to separate. ANOVA, those two parts are variation because the groups are different, and just inherent variation that exists. Try to understand why or where this variation is coming from. Okay? So whenever you grab a bunch of people, you know, everybody's different. And we could say, oh, well, people are different. You know, let's say we were looking at people's heights, right? You grab a bunch of people, everyone's different. Okay, some people are taller, some people are shorter. And what ANOVA tries to do is it tries to parse out the reasons why people are different, okay? Because overall, somebody could just say, why are people different heights? The answer is people are just different heights, okay? And that's true. But somebody else could parse out that difference. They could say, first off, we can look at the sex of a person, okay? And we could say, some people are taller and some people are shorter because some people are men and some people are women. And in general, men are taller than women. And then among the men, so that's one reason why some people are different heights. And then among the men, yes, you've got tall men and short men, so you've got variation there. And among the women, you've got tall women and short women, so you've got variation there, okay? But we've basically split out the total variation, so the reason why everybody has different heights there's different heights in the world, we say, okay, well, some of it can be attributed to different sexes, and then just within each sex, people are different heights, okay? Or, so that's only with two groups, but we could apply it to, different characteristics. So maybe we go off of ethnicity and we have maybe more than two categories and we say, people of this ethnicity tend to be tall and people of this ethnicity tend to be shorter and things like that. And we could say, okay, so you've got some variation there and then within each group you also have more variation, so on and so forth. So we're trying with ANOVA, we're trying to figure out how much of the total variation can be attributed to the fact that groups are different, and then how much of it is just the inherent variation that's going to exist within any group. Okay. So, yes?
Was this technique used in the study that we did a lab on? For this, it just sounds... Yeah, like a very similar process of trying to figure out if there's a statistical difference because the groups are different, or because there's a lot of variation between people.
Yeah, they do the baseline characteristics to try to make sure that the treatment group and the control group are similar to begin with. Okay, so I guess there's a similar reasoning, but it's a little bit different. Okay, because ANOVA, I guess, applies to the analysis, and that article didn't use ANOVA, but it did separate out the treatment and the control group, and it created baseline characteristics so that you can see that the two groups seem to be relatively similar, okay? Based on, because of random assignment, the two groups happen to end up fairly similar, so that whenever, so if at the end of the experiment we saw a difference between the two groups, it could be attributed to the fact that one was treatment and one was control, and not for any other of the other baseline characteristics.
So making sure that the baseline groups were similar in advance,
right,
circumvented the need to do or to use ANOVA?
I wouldn't say that. I mean, we didn't need to use ANOVA because there's only two groups.
Oh, right, okay.
It's just so the, if there were to be a difference observed between the two groups, we can say the reason why that's different is because of the experimental treatment versus control, rather than someone saying, now you came to different conclusions because this group happened to have this trait and this group happened to have this other trait that's unrelated to what we're going after. That's the reason why we did that. Okay. But back to here, let me just copy some data from book. Alright, so here we've got three groups, and these are, we've got lambs, and they were put on three different diets. Okay. And we had a total of 12 lamb, and these are how much the lambs gained, how much weight they gained on the different diets. So the lambs gained different amounts of weight. And what we want to know is, well, are the lambs gaining different amounts of weights because the diets are a factor, meaning one diet causes more weight gain than another diet? Or are lambs gaining different amounts of weights because lambs are just different from each other? Okay, or is it a combination of both? Okay, I mean, well, certainly individual differences will always be a part of this. That's unavoidable. But we want to know, is there a difference due to the fact that the diets are different, or is there no real difference at all? Okay. So we look at the sample mean of each and the standard deviation. So the sample mean here is 11.0, the sample mean here is 15.0, the sample mean here is 12.0, and our standard deviation 4.359, 4.950, 4.167. Okay. There's a concept of grand mean. The grand mean is, what's the total mean of all the lambs? Okay, so I've got a total of 12, right? 12. Okay. So the grand mean would be if I added all 12 numbers up and divided by 12. Okay, simple enough, right? All the lambs. get that, though, is, you know, sometimes we're not given the actual individual data. So here we have, you know, 3 lamb, 5 lamb, and 4 lamb. So that's simple enough, okay? But if we had, you know, 100 in this group and 200 in this group and 150 in another group or something like that, we don't want to have to add up all of those numbers. So sometimes we're just given summary statistics, such as the group mean, and we're told that this one had 3, and this one had 5, and this one had 4, okay? We can kind of reverse the total, because we know 12 is equal to the sum of everything divided by 4, right? So I can get reverse the sum by doing 12 times 4. So I can get a weighted everything by doing n times y bar, and I add this up for each group. And then divide by the sum of the n's. So I can do 3 times 11 plus 5 times 15 plus 4 times 12 divided by 3 plus 5 plus 4. I get 13. That's easy. Okay, so my grand mean, the symbol that we use for grand mean is y double bar. This is equal to 13.0. Let me draw a picture on here. I hope this picture illustrates what I want it to say. So let me just, I'm going to make a column for, so if I just created a dot plot for all the lambs, okay, I would have a dot at 8, and a dot at 16, and a dot at 9, and another dot at 9, another dot at 16, a dot at 21, 11, 18, 15, 10, 17, and 6. Okay. So I've got a bunch of different dots. This is just all the lambs are different weights. Let me separate these out. Say these are the lambs on diet 1, these are the lambs on diet 2, and these are the lambs on diet 3. Thank you. Something like that. Alright, I'm going to draw a line. This line right here at 13. This symbolizes the grand mean. That is the grand mean. I think this one is wrong. This is 11. So that has to be down here. Okay, well anyway. It's hard to do it on the chalkboard. Okay, so this represents the grand mean. And the total variation, okay, if we think back to the definition of variation, is that it's the idea of the squared distance from the mean, right? The, quote, average squared distance from the mean. So we can get this, if I don't worry about the average part, and I just look up the squared distance from the mean, I can get the total squared distance from the mean, and that's, you know, how far was this point from the mean? And how far was this point from the mean? And how far was this point from the mean? And I square each of those things, and I do that for all 12 points here. Okay, I can come up with a sum of squares. Total sum of squares. Okay, and that's going to be each point y, I subtract the grand mean from it, and I square it, and I add that up for all 12 points, right? I do that for every single one of my points. I go, how far was this guy from me? So on and so forth. And I square it, and I add that up for all of them. So that's going to be my total sum of squares. Okay, so this kind of illustrates the idea of, excuse me, the total variation. But we're going to try to parse that out into two parts here. So we've separated these out into three diet groups. We've got diet 1, diet 2, and diet 3. Okay. The mean of diet 1 is 11. So I'm going to draw a line right there to symbolize 11. The mean of diet 2 is 15. Which I draw right there. And the mean of diet 3 is 12. These are the mean of each group. So if somebody says, hey, why is this point not the same as the mean, okay? There's two parts to the answer. We can say, well, one, this point belongs to diet one, okay? And diet one, the average of diet one, is different from the mean. Okay, so part of the reason why this point is different is because the average of diet 1 is this far from the mean. And then the other part of the answer is, well, and it's just an individual lamb, and even though it belonged to diet 1, it was different from the rest of diet, from the average of diet 1. Okay, so there's two parts, okay? One is that the group, the average of the group is different from the average of everything. Okay, so we've got basically a difference because of the group, and then for each individual point, there's a difference between the point and the group's mean. Okay, and then the same can be said for this one. Okay, why is this point different from the grand mean? Well, part of it is because its group is different. And then the rest of the reason is because it individually is different from the average of the group, okay? And the same for this one. Part of it's due to the fact that the group is different, and then individually, it's different from the average of the group. So we can do this for all of the points in our data, okay? And that separates out, we've got the sum of squares because the groups are different, and then we've got the sum of squares that just exist within the groups. Okay, so I've got sum of squares between groups, and I've got the sum of squares within groups. Okay. So I think maybe it's easiest to start off with the sum of squares within the groups. The sum of squares within the groups is the difference between the dot, an individual point, and its group's mean. Okay? So that is equal to an individual point minus the mean of the group. Okay, so I've got y bar, just one bar there. This is the mean of that group. In the book, it adds a bunch of subscripts. Okay, it puts I's and J's to indicate this thing belongs to a group and this one belongs to everything. And I think it's a little bit easier to leave off the subscripts, okay? Just in terms of explanation. So this is each point, and we're subtracting off if the points mean of the group, okay? The mean of the group that the point belongs to, okay? So I take that difference and I square it. And I do this for all points in the group, and I do it for all groups. Okay, so I'm gonna do this for all of the points in the data set, okay? All points in the data set. Okay. This is slightly sloppy notation. Okay, you're technically supposed to have two summation symbols, one to signify all points within a group, second summation symbol to show do the same thing for all groups. Okay. I think it's easy to just leave it with one summation symbol and say for all points in your data set. Okay, and I hope that's okay. So when you go through the textbook, you'll see two summation symbols, and that's because they're being a little bit more formal with the notation, as they should, because it's a textbook. But just for here, I'm saying, just do it for all the points in the data set, okay? Okay, so we're gonna do that for all 12 points, okay? So I say, oh, why is this point different? Okay, well, part of it is because it's due to the fact that its group is different from the rest, and it itself was a little bit different from its group mean. So I have the sum of squares within the groups, that's this thing, okay? And the sum of squares between the groups, okay? We're gonna take this difference, the difference between a group's mean, y bar, how different is it from the grand mean, y double bar, and we're gonna square that difference. Okay, let's say y bar minus y double bar, okay? So I'm gonna take that difference there, okay? But the thing is this group only had three lambs, so I do it three times for this group. But this group had five lambs, so I have to do it five times for this group. And this one had four, so I have to do it four times for this group, okay? So I'm gonna take the difference between the group's mean and the grand mean, I'm going to square that difference, but I'm going to multiply it by how many were in that group. And then I add that up, okay? So let me just rewrite this so I can annotate it a little bit better. This is the group mean. This is the grand mean, and this is the number in the group. Okay, and we add this up for all of the groups.
So in this case, you would perform that operation three separate times and add them together.
Yes. Yeah. I would do this three times and add them together. And this one, I would have to do it for all 12 points, okay? So we're trying to separate, or I don't know, I guess the total variance, we're trying to separate or analyze, okay? The analysis of variance in NOVA. So we're taking the total variance and we're trying to break it out into subcomponents. And so that's what we've got going on here. Okay. So the truth is I could just leave you with these formulas here, and you could do an ANOVA analysis right here, okay? Or at least get you pretty far in the ANOVA analysis, okay? The problem is, well, not the problem, but this calculation would become rather tedious, okay? Because you have to do this for all 12 points, and, you know, and that's with this tiny data set, right? A data set with only 12 points, that's not very many, okay? So we have a shortcut to give us this answer. Just a slightly more complicated formula. Okay. Just a shortcut to get the sum of squares within. Okay, and so. Sometimes to abbreviate, we will write SS within. Okay, sum of squares within again is the difference between each individual point and its group mean squared. Okay, for all data points. Okay, so because we don't want to have to do this for all 12 data points, okay, so we have a slight, maybe a shortcut. So let's think back. Definition of a standard deviation would be the square root of what? Sum of y minus y bar quantity squared divided by n minus 1, right? Okay, so can I solve for this using this? Yes, yes I can. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to square both sides. Okay, so now I have s squared is equal to this thing. Okay, and then I'm going to multiply both sides by n minus 1. And I get this thing. So a shortcut for sum of squares within is I do n minus 1 times s squared, but this exists only for each group, so I have to do this not for all data points now, but for all groups. Okay, so this is kind of where maybe the sloppy notation bites me, but here we can get this back by doing n minus 1 times s squared, and I do it for all of the groups. And that's going to give me the sum of squares.
So that's really only a shortcut if you're given...
Yeah, it's a shortcut if you're given the standard deviation. You're right. It's not a shortcut if you're just given the data points and you're not given the standard deviation. And the truth is, if you're given a whole bunch of data points in kind of a raw format or something, just throw them at a computer and have it do the analysis, right? Because to try to calculate the standard deviation by hand and then to do all of these things by hand, you're just inviting yourself to make some silly mistake along the way. Okay? But, you know, I guess for a test or for your homework, these shortcuts help. Okay. But either way is it's fine. Okay. All right. so that's what we have. Okay, so let's figure out our sum of squares within, sum of squares between, and total sum of squares. Okay, so there's a nice relationship in that if I do the sum of squares between, okay, plus the sum of squares within, it adds up to the sum of squares total. So that's a nice little thing. This is sum of squares within. And sum of squares between is equal to n times y bar minus y bar squared. Okay, summed up. So let's get our sum of squares between and our sum of squares within. So our y double bar is 13, so sum of squares between is going to be 11 minus 13 squared times, how many data points do I have in group 1? 3. So that's saying, okay, this group's mean is 2 away from the grand mean, so I square that, and I multiply it by 3, 1, which is basically 1 for each data point that I have. Diet 2 has a grand mean of 15, I mean not grand mean, has a group mean of 15, which is also 2 units away from the grand mean. I'm going to square that difference, and it counts 5 times, 1 for each of its data points. And I do the same thing for the last one. I got 4 times 3 plus 4 times 5 plus 1 times 4. What is that? 36. 4 times 36. So I get a sum of squares between equal to 36. Sum of squares within, we could go either way, all right? I could do the definition of sum of squares within, but I have to do this for all 12 points. It's not too bad, there's only 12. Okay, or I could use this shortcut, okay? The shortcut's gonna give us, if I use these numbers directly, these numbers provided to us, because of some rounding issues, this number's gonna be just ever so slightly off, okay? We'll just use the shortcut here. So I do 3 minus 1, which gives me 2, times 4.359 squared, plus 5 minus 1, 4, times 4.95 squared, plus 3 times 4.967. The calculator, there's a few extra decimals, but again, that's because of some rounding issues. The true number is 210. Okay, so my sum of squares between is 36, my sum of squares within is 210, my sum of squares total will be 246, okay? And you can verify it yourself. You could do 8 minus the grand mean, 13. Square it plus 16 minus 13 squared, and you do this for all 12 points. Okay, subtract the grand mean from each of them, and you would get 246. Okay, so that's sum of squares between, sum of squares within. Okay, 36, 210. So we have to to answer our question is are the these diets, okay, the group means are a little bit different, are different from each other. Are they an indication that their respective populations have different means, or is it possible that from random chance or random selection we happen to get group means that were different, right? Because again, our null hypothesis is that the means, the group means, or the population means of each respective group is the same, and the alternative is that at least one is different. Create an ANOVA table, and these numbers are going to play a central part. The other part that is also important in our ANOVA table are the degrees of freedom. So the ANOVA table looks like this. Okay. We list off the sources of variation, and for one-way ANOVA, the sources of variation is between the groups, between group variation, and within group variation. Okay. Sometimes this is known as the error or the residual term. Source, we list off the degrees of freedom, and then we list off the sum of squares. The degrees of freedom, total degrees of freedom, is the total number of points minus one. The between group degrees of freedom is the number of categories minus one. And for whatever reason, I is the number of categories. Okay. This is same thing, same property holds true for degrees of freedom. It's that this plus this must equal this. So how many degrees of freedom do I have for the within group term? N minus I. N minus the number of categories. And so that this plus this adds up to this. We've already talked about the sum of squares between and the sum of squares within. These add up to sum of squares total. And then we have a mean squares term. Okay? And the mean squares is always the sum of squares divided by the degrees of freedom. Okay? So it's just this thing divided by this thing. Okay, so I do the sum of squares between divided by degrees of freedom, I minus one. And then here it's the sum of squares within divided by N minus one. Is this okay? I don't know.
Sorry, what's MS?
MS is known as mean squares. Okay, mean squares. squares, doesn't really matter.
Alright.
Okay, and then so all of this, we've broken out, again, just to recap where we're going, and because all of this just seems like gibberish and rigmarole here. We've taken the total sum of squares, which gives us an idea of the total variation. We've broken it out into two components. One is because the groups are different, and one is just inherently individuals are different, even within the groups. Okay? We divide that by the degrees of freedom. Partly because the sum of squares grows with the degrees of freedom. So kind of, I don't know, to get like an average, the mean squares term. Okay, so we divide that. And then we're going to compare this term to this term, okay? And we want to see if this is much bigger than this one or not. Okay, and if it's much bigger, then we would have an indication that the sum of squares between the group is a significant contributor to the overall variation. If this thing is not much bigger than this, or if it's smaller than this, then we would say the difference between the groups is not a significant contributor to the fact that, or is not a significant contributor to the overall variation. Okay. So there's a, and we call, so we just do this divided by this, okay? And that is the F term. Okay, so we do the mean squares between divided by mean squares within. Just take a ratio between the two. If this thing is large, if the mean squares between is much larger than the mean squares within, that gives us evidence or is an indication to us that the variation between the groups is a significant contributor to the overall variation. And if it's not large, okay, compared to the within group variation, then we would say the variation between the groups is not a significant contributor to the overall variation. And that helps us answer our original question, which is, are the means, could they be the same, or do we have evidence that at least one of the means is different? Okay, so this F term, this is our test statistic, and we would look it up in a reference table to get our answer, to get our p-value. Okay? So this is the test statistic. The F ratio. Excuse me. It's our test statistic. And we look it up. Let's complete an ANOVA table. Source. One is between the diets. And here, this is just within. Our degrees of freedom. Okay. So, the total degrees of freedom, I've got a total of 12 lambs that I observed. So, my total degrees of freedom sorry, 11. 11. Okay? 11 degrees of freedom total. Okay? I've got three different diets, so my degrees of freedom between the diets is what? 2. Okay? And then it's this plus this has to add up to this. Sum of squares, and we've already done the calculations for these, but you might want to look back into your notes if you need to. At 36, the sum of squares between the diets is 36 total, within the diets, 210 total, total of 246. Mean squares, I'm going to give 36 divided by 2. 18. And then within, I do 210 divided by 9. And I don't know if that is 23. So my F is going to be 18 divided by 23.33. I get an F ratio of 0.771. Okay. So far, so good. So now we look this up in the F table. All right, so it's in the back of your textbook. It's not in the packet that I handed out because the F table is like 10 pages long in our textbook, and in a real F table it could be even longer if it wanted to be. That's because there's two degrees of freedom that we're looking up, okay? One is the degrees of freedom between and the degrees of freedom within. And it's, we've got the, what, numerator degrees of freedom and the denominator degrees of freedom, okay? So, basically, I did 18 divided by 23.3. The 18 corresponds to this top row, so the numerator degrees of freedom is 2. The 23.3 was in this row, so that corresponds to my denominator degrees of freedom, which is 9. Okay, so I have numerator DF equal to 2 and denominator DF equal to 9. Okay. And there's a different page in the F table for each different numerator degrees of freedom. So if my numerator degrees of freedom is 1, there's an entire page for that. If my numerator degrees of freedom is 2, then I go to the next page, and so on and so forth. There's a whole bunch of pages. So that's why I didn't bother including it in your reference table, because it would be too many tables to include, or too many additional pages. So in this case, I'm just going to go to the page 629, which says numerator degrees of freedom 2, and then I go to the row 9. Okay? And now I am looking for I'm looking for my test statistic there, okay? So this is for numerator DF equal to 2, and I go to the row for denominator degrees of freedom. And the first number I have there is 1.93. And that has a tail probability of 0.2. And then the next number, they just keep getting larger, 3.01 has a tail probability of 10. So anyway, my test statistic is 0.0771. So my numerator, my mean squares for the between diets is actually smaller than the mean squares within the diets, okay? So overall it's saying the within diet variation is a larger contributor to the overall variation than the between the diets, okay? So the variation that exists within the diets here is basically larger than the variation due to the fact that the diets are different. And so anyway, I get this, and so here my p-value, whatever it would be, is going to be greater than 20%. So I would say I do not reject the null hypothesis. Okay, I do not have evidence.
The totals in the ANOVA table for anything?
No. Yeah. You could ignore this if you wanted to. Alright. Are there any questions on this? Where any of the numbers came from or anything like that? So one of the limitations of ANOVA is that what if, you know, let's say we went through this thing and we rejected the null hypothesis. Let's say my F ratio was huge. I looked it up on the F table and my P value is tiny, okay? So my P value is like 1%. Value is 1%. So here I would reject the null hypothesis. Okay, I would accept the alternative. And then we would say we have evidence is it doesn't tell you which one, okay? So with ANOVA, you could have 6 groups, and then you run the test, and it goes p-value tiny, reject the null hypothesis. And you're like, oh, great, one of my means is different. But then it doesn't tell you which one, okay? So ANOVA can't tell you which group has the different mean. You can speculate, and sometimes you look at the data and you're like, oh, it looks like it's this one, but the ANOVA test itself is unable to tell you which group has the different mean. Which group? wanted to know which group has the different mean, that would require you to do t-tests, comparing one mean versus another mean, and then you run into the problem of multiple comparisons again, okay? So there's kind of this problem that we can't avoid. But ANOVA allows us to test the null hypothesis that all groups are the same or not, okay? And maybe you find out that you don't have evidence to reject that, and then you don't have to worry about anything else. But let's say you do reject the null hypothesis, it won't tell you which group has a different group. Okay. Are there any questions on that? Yes.
So it also won't tell you if you have more than one group, it has a radically different mean?
Right.
Just know that
so
at least one?
It just says at least one, okay? So it's... it's good that it'll say something's different, but it won't say which one, okay? So that's one of the limitations in ANOVA, okay? But it is very useful, and this is, we're just covering one way ANOVA. I'm going to introduce maybe some of the other ANOVA, okay? But and I'll talk about, you know, kind of when they are used. But we won't go into the legwork of actually doing one of those more complicated ANOVA analyses. Basically takes the overall variation splits it up into different sources, okay? The overall variation splits it up. Always be residual variation, okay? It's just the fact that everyone is different. So the ANOVA, or its analysis, is that it just takes a ratio between one of the sources and compares it to the variation within the group, so the residual variation, residual sum of squares. Source.